Little trip down memory lane there. And Nicola Sturgeon is here. Welcome, First Minister, welcome to The Nine. We have a lot to get into with regards to the election. But first of all, I just want to briefly mention the Alex Salmond case. Now, we are very conscious this is an active criminal case. There are things that we can't ask and things that you cannot answer. But isn't this case, whatever the basis or the outcome, a distraction to your campaign?
No, and it's my job to make sure it's not, as far as my conduct of the campaign is. As you rightly say, and I appreciate you acknowledging this, it's a live criminal case, and it would be not just inappropriate, it's not possible for me to comment in any way, shape or form on that. I think the only thing I can say and the only thing I will say, and I say this not just as First Minister, but as a citizen, just like everybody else, what matters to me is that justice is done, whatever that might be. And for that to happen, we have to respect the job of the court and allow due process to take its course.
Thank you.
Can we move briefly on to the election? In the last general election, two-thirds of the Scottish electorate did not vote for you. That's true, isn't it?
We won the election, though.
Two-thirds of the Scottish people did not vote for you. Only 3% of the UK vote is SNP. You said on the TV after the leaders' debate, both Boris Johnson and Jeremy Corbyn are unsuitable as leaders, but I don't rule out a progressive alliance. That's just a deal in fancy words, isn't it?
Look, we might hold the balance of power. I'm trying to be as straight with people as possible. The SNP won't be in a formal coalition, but yes, we would look to work with other parties as part of what I've called a progressive alliance to keep the Conservatives out of office. If Labour was in a position, and we don't know whether they will be or not yet, to form a minority government, then I'd be willing to discuss an arrangement like that. And of course, I know what is required in these situations because I lead a minority government right now in Scotland, and any minority government needs to work with other parties to get policies.
We've heard you say that before, but we've got Trident just up the river, and the Labour Party have said they would renew Trident. That must be one of your red lines. And if you're in a hung parliament with no majority, you'd have to give away everything you believe to stop the Tories getting in. If you don't, the Tories get in.
Well, that's not the case. Any minority government, I would never support the Tories. I would never do anything to put the Tories into office or to support the Tories in office.
No, but I think my point, though, is that if you don't concede on your red lines with Labour, then the Tories get in.
I think I would reverse that question to some extent. If you imagine that we're on the 13th of December, the day after the election, and against all of the predictions, all of the opinion poll suggestions that Jeremy Corbyn and Labour are in a position to form a minority government, then the onus would be on them to win support for other parties and to look at where they would be prepared to compromise. The SNP has to do that right now in the Scottish Parliament every year to get our budget through. And Jeremy Corbyn and Labour would have a lot of explaining to do if they walked away from the opportunity of a Labour government at UK level because they weren't willing to compromise.
OK, so the Labour Party launched its manifesto today and they kind of tried to make clear their stance on whether or not they would allow you to have or give you a second independence referendum. Would it be tolerable to you if they said not in the first formative years? Would you give them your support?
Because for me it's an issue of principle, and the principle is this one, that the question of if there is an independence referendum, and secondly, what the timescale of that independence referendum would be, is not a matter for Westminster to determine or to dictate. It's a matter for the Scottish people to decide through their democratically elected Scottish Parliament. Now, that's the principle of self-determination. It's one that Labour and Jeremy Corbyn in particular seem to support for most other countries in the world. And I think it would be strange if they were to give up their chance at government because they were arguing over a year or so.
So you would absolutely stand firm on 2020.
I've been very clear that, and you know, I think most people, whatever their views on independence, would think this not unreasonable. As the leader of the SNP, for any Westminster leader to look to the SNP for support, if they're not prepared to accept the principle of the right of the Scottish people to decide their own future, then I don't think they should accept that support. For what it's worth, I think Jeremy Corbyn will, because I don't think he will want to explain to people why he's turning his back on a Labour government.
But there would be no movement on timescale. You'd absolutely stand firm on 2020.
That is my position, yes. And that is based on a principle, and that's my very firm position.
When was the last time you spoke to him?
A couple of weeks before the election was called, I was in Westminster. It was during one of the many Brexit fiascos, and we had a discussion about the current state of play. We actually had a discussion at that point about whether or not there was going to be an election. We haven't discussed, I think Jeremy Corbyn knows my views on independence.
You haven't discussed it at referendum. All?
We've not had discussions about what might happen.
He's discussing it publicly,
election.
And as are you. It would seem a bit strange.
I think we'll let the voters vote and then see what the parliamentary arithmetic holds. The reason, in my view, the reason Jeremy Corbyn and to a lesser extent the Tories are getting themselves into such a mess on this issue with positions that are changing almost every day is that they know the only democratically defensible position is to say it's up to the people of Scotland to decide, not for Westminster to dictate. And as soon as they depart from that, they tie themselves in knots.
OK, so say if Jeremy Corbyn does get into power, would you see two referendums next year?
Well, look,
do you think the people of Scotland want that?
Well, the people of Scotland don't want to leave the EU, and there is rising support for Scotland becoming independent. Now, the UK is in a mess right now. It's not a mess of my making, and it's got to plot its way out of that mess, in my view. I'm not in control of whether or not there will be a second EU referendum. I've said very consistently and clearly that if a government brings forward a proposition for that, the SNP will support it. But, of course, there's no guarantee in a second EU referendum that we get a different outcome from the last one. We could still have a situation where Scotland votes to remain, the rest of the UK votes to leave. The way to solve that problem of having our future determined by Westminster is to be independent.
So this election is about Brexit and independence, isn't it, pretty much? And you commissioned the Fraser Valent Institute to look at potential job losses in Scotland because of Brexit in 2016. This is because 18% of our exports are to the EU, correct?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you predicted, do you remember?
I don't know what you're asking me, so you better ask me the question rather than
can you remember can you remember the figure of job losses predicted?
I don't remember precisely, no, but I'm sure you're about to tell me.
Well, I can remind you, it was 80,000. Mm-hmm. So 18% of our exports in Scotland are to the EU. Do you know what our exports are to the rest
of
the UK?
We've got substantial exports to the rest of the UK, but
it's 60%.
There is nothing in what I am proposing that is to disrupt the trade between Scotland and the rest of the UK.
But that sounds like Boris Johnson talking about the EU. Can I just give you the numbers? The Fraser Valent Institute say, examining Scottish Government figures, that there are three times as many jobs reliant on exports to the rest of the UK as to the EU. So potential job losses from independence are three times those of
Brexit.
That's
not the case, because I am not proposing something that disrupts trade between Scotland
and the rest of... Well, that's what Boris Johnson says, too.
Well, if you let me finish the point. Actually, trade from England to Scotland is just as important to the UK economy. It is not my policy that is threatening borders or trade disruption. It is Brexit. And one of the reasons why I have been arguing so strongly for not just Scotland, but for the whole of the UK to remain within the single market and the customs union.
But hasn't Brexit showed how difficult independence would be?
Can I come on to that point in a second? Can I finish this point that I was making? The UK market is important to Scotland. Of course it is important
to
Scotland.
Yeah, but 60% of our exports.
But this European single market is eight times the size of the UK market. Our exports to the European market are increasing right now. If you look at the experience of Ireland after it became independent and then when it joined the European Union, that combination of independence and EU membership allowed it to grow its exports internationally and to become more prosperous. Scotland shouldn't be in the position of having to choose between the UK market and the eight times bigger single market. I want Scotland to trade in the UK, but I don't want us to lose out on the European single market. Now, before I forget your next question, no, I don't accept that premise. The reason I oppose Brexit, and I oppose it strongly and in principle, but it was not inevitable that Brexit became the mess it's become. That was down to the fact that those who proposed it weren't honest about the consequences. There was no information in detail given in advance of the referendum. There was no planning done. Theresa May then came out with her contradictory red lines. The contrast with that and the independence referendum is stark. There was a detailed proposition. There was planning done.
OK, thank you. So you don't agree with the economists and you think independence will be plain sailing.
You made a jump from what the economists had said to the scenario in independence. Okay. I'm saying you're comparing apples and pears there.
OK, I want to move on to what so many people call the day job. And many voters would say that you are just simply not doing well enough with the powers that you already have, you know, whether that be education, whether that be health. And they are right, aren't they?
Well, firstly, I'll come on to specifically the issues in health and education in a second, but your opening statement there, many voters would say,
Many people would say.
You said voters and people, but if you look at satisfaction ratings for the NHS, they remain close to a record high. If you look at the social attitude survey around education, the vast majority of people, a very, very high percentage of people, particularly those who have children in our schools, say that they're satisfied or very satisfied with the state of our schools.
But when you see the problems with the health service at the moment, you must be concerned.
Well, look, of course, when there are challenges and problems in our health service, most of what happens in our health service is excellent, but when things go wrong, all governments have to face up to that. Our health service is no different there, and we face up to these challenges. All health services across the world are facing rising demand. The difference actually with Scotland's health service is that we are putting in the investment, we're making the reforms, and if you look at the most recent Audit Scotland report, while it had tough and challenging things to say, it said again 7 of the 8 key waiting times, more people were being seen within those waiting times this year than last year. So the investments we're making, the reforms we're making are having an effect, and that's why we've got an 850 million waiting times improvement plan, and we're determined to carry on with that. If you look at our accident and emergency departments, for 4 years or more, the best performing in the whole of the UK.
It's not just money, though, is it?
Of course, that's why everything is being managed, isn't it? Well, that's why you're absolutely right. It's not just money. Investment is important, but so is reform. So we're the first country in the UK to integrate health and social care, to bring these services together. So there's work still to be done there. I'm the last person to sit here and say that there is not, but we're focused on these issues and we're making the investments, we're doing the reforms, and we're going to see them through.
Okay, I think yesterday it was you marked 5 years in power. Tell us, I mean, what does the future hold? Are you going to be here still in 5 years' well, time, First Minister?
Look, I'll be here as long, firstly, as the people of Scotland want me to be doing this job. We've got an election not for the Scottish Parliament in a few weeks, and people have got a chance to cast a verdict on the SNP. I look forward to leading my party into the next Scottish election, and I'm not complacent but confident about our prospects there. But secondly, of course, subject to the will of the people in my party, I'll keep doing the job for as long as I think I'm the best person to do the job and I've got a contribution to make.
Okay. Nicola Sturgeon, thank you very much.
Thank you very much for talking to us. Thank you very much indeed, First Minister.